In a linear algebra course, matrix inverses are something that get a lot of attention. There are all these formulas thrown at you, like for the determinant, the inverse of 2x2 matrices, Cramner's rule, etc., etc. These formulas are great, but I think that they can obscure the very simple idea behind what an inverse actually is, and when it exists. You've probably been taught that the inverse exists if and only if the determinant isn't zero. But most students have no idea what the determinant has to do with anything, let alone inverses. I'm going to teach you a completely different condition for when the inverse exists that I think is much more intuitive. But before all that, do you know what a linear transformation is? If not, go watch my last video because none of this is going to make any sense at all otherwise. In fact, if you want to brush up on vectors and bases, you can watch the video before that too. Even though this video is about matrix inverses, I'm not going to define what an inverse is straight away. Instead, I'm going to define something called a left inverse, because I think understanding these first will give you a better intuition for inverses themselves. Imagine you have a bunch of vectors in some vector space, in this case 2D, and you apply some matrix M on them. Here it rotates them. Then you think you'd like to have undone what you just did and get the vectors back to where they were. In this example, what transform undoes the rotation? You just rotate everything back by the same angle, right? That's all a left inverse is. It's the matrix that undoes the original matrix, so it's like you've done nothing at all. If I wanted to write this as an equation, it'd say, if you do M and then you do L, it's the same as if you did nothing. This thing is called the identity matrix, by the way, and it just means the transformation where you do nothing. This thing is called the left inverse for hopefully obvious reasons. So now we know the left inverse is a matrix that undoes the original matrix's action. The annoying thing about inverses is really their name. It sounds like the inverse should be the thing that undoes a matrix. Instead, the definition of M inverse is M inverse undoes M and M undoes M inverse. Going back to our example, if you do M first and then L, that's the identity. But it's also true that if you did L first, then M, you'd also get the identity. So since L undoes M and is undone by M, L and M are inverses of each other. You might wonder, is the left inverse also always the inverse? Obviously not, or they wouldn't have different names, would they? Before we move on, let me ask you a question to check you've understood this so far. Imagine you have a matrix like this. What it does is it takes a 3D vector and then jumbles up the components. Does this matrix have a left inverse? As in, can you undo this? Then if it does have a left inverse, figure out if it has an inverse as well. Put your answer in the poll in the corner and pause the video now to think about it. The answer is that it does have a left inverse. It's the one that takes a vector like this and rearranges the components like this. It's clear that this is a left inverse of A since it undoes it like so. But A is also a left inverse of it, as you can see, because A undoes this matrix. So B is the inverse of A. Now that we know what an inverse is, let's think more about when they exist and don't. Again, it's going to be more convenient to look at when a left inverse exists first. Here's another question. This matrix takes a 2D vector, AB, and sends it to A0. Does this matrix have a left inverse? If so, figure out what it is. Again, put your answer in the poll in the corner and pause now to think about it. Notice something about this matrix. It takes the vector AB to A0, but it also takes AD to A0 as well. This is a bad thing, and it's because of this that the left inverse doesn't exist. Why? Well, say you have some vector V and M takes it to W. The left inverse of M, if it exists, knows M and what W is, but it doesn't know what the vector that produced W was. Just using the information given, it needs to find out what the original vector was so that it can take W back to where it came from. However, if there's some other vector U that also goes to W, the left inverse has a problem. It can't just look at W and know for sure whether it came from V or from U because there isn't enough information. This means that the left inverse can't take W back where it came from, and so it doesn't exist. This thing here, where two different vectors V and U get mapped to the same vector, i.e. MU equals MV, is what I'll call M losing information. What we've just seen is that if M loses information, it doesn't have a left inverse. But what about the other way around? If M doesn't lose information, does this mean that the left inverse exists? Well, yes, actually, because all the left inverse has to do to undo M is find the vector W came from. Since there's only one vector V it could be, there is an inverse that takes W and returns V. This doesn't mean it's easy to find out what V is necessarily, but looking at W does in principle give you enough information to undo M and return V. So a matrix has a left inverse if and only if it doesn't lose information. Let's look at another example to understand this point better. Imagine I have a matrix from 2D to 3D, and what it does is it rotates any 2D vector into 3D space like this. Does this matrix have a left inverse? Pause the video to think about it. The answer is that it does have a left inverse because A doesn't lose information. If you want to take vectors like this back, you know where they came from, so all you have to do is rotate this plane back. Let B be a matrix that takes 3D vectors to 2D that does rotate this plane back. It is a left inverse of A. Now, is B the inverse of A? In other words, is A B's left inverse? Pause the video and think about it. The answer is no. B has no left inverse. We'll show that by showing that B loses information. First, pick any 3D vector that's on this plane. B has to send it to some 2D vector, so let's just say it's here. But there's another 3D vector that's already been sent there. It's this vector U that's on the plane. So BU is equal to BV. Hence, B loses information and doesn't have a left inverse. There's an important lesson to be drawn from this example. You might have wondered why we only ever talk about the inverses of square matrices. What's so special about transformations from n dimensions to n dimensions? The reason is non-square matrices, i.e. ones from n dimensions to m dimensions, never have an inverse. The issue is, if you have any transformation going from a bigger space to a smaller space, like B, which went from 3D to 2D, you have to lose information. These types of matrices always send some vectors to the same place. If you have a matrix from a smaller to a bigger dimension, it is possible for it to have a left inverse, like A did in our example. But its left inverse goes from big to small, like B, and so it can't be undone. Hence, even though some non-square matrices have left inverses, they never have an inverse. Square matrices don't have these issues at all though. Actually, for square matrices, everything massively simplifies because the left inverse is always equal to the inverse. So if a square matrix has a left inverse, it automatically has an inverse. I'm not going to prove this fact. You are, for homework. But I will give you an illustrative example in a little to help you understand why it's true. Once you've proved it, you'll see that for a square matrix A, if B undoes A, then A undoes B as well. This gives us an easy criteria for checking whether A has an inverse or not, because it's the same criteria we use to check whether A has a left inverse. Just ask, does A lose information? If yes, then sorry, A inverse doesn't exist. But if no, then A inverse does exist. You might be thinking, okay, so what? How is this easy to check? Wouldn't you have to compute the outcome of every single vector that goes into M and then compare the results to every other vector and see if any of them match? Isn't that beyond tedious? Thankfully, there is an easy way to check this condition. All you have to do is figure out which vectors get mapped to zero. For any linear map, zero is always mapped to zero. But all you need to do is find out if there are any other vectors mapped to zero or not. And that's enough to decide if M loses information. Why would that be enough? Imagine two vectors, U and V, both go to W, so M loses information. Then the vector U minus V, by linearity, gets mapped to zero. So whenever you have two vectors going to the same thing like this, you always get at least two vectors ending up at zero. So you can check whether a matrix loses information by just checking how many things go to zero. In other words, figure out how many vectors B satisfy the equation MV equals zero. This is part of why you spend so much time in a linear algebra course studying the solution to equations like this. You can solve for V by A, using substitution, B, using Gaussian elimination, or C, getting your computer to do the Gaussian elimination for you. The point is, you can find out if M loses information easily enough this way, and that tells you whether M has an inverse. Let me summarize quickly what we learned in this video. 1. A left inverse of a matrix is a matrix that undoes it. 2. That the left inverse exists if you don't lose information, i.e. if the matrix never sends two different vectors to the same vector. 3. The inverse is the matrix that both undoes the matrix and is undone by the matrix. 4. Non-square matrices never have inverses. 5. For a square matrix, the left inverse is equal to the inverse. 6. You only need to check if a square matrix loses information or not to decide whether it has an inverse. And 7. You can check whether the matrix loses information by looking at how many different vectors get mapped to zero. This you can do by solving the equation MV equals zero. And so that's it. But before you run off, here's some homework for you. The first one is multiple choice. Which of these is the inverse of this matrix? I know that you can just check each of these to see which one works, but I'd rather you did it another way. And for crying out loud, don't use the formula for the inverse. Once you've figured it out, put your answer in the poll. Question 2. Prove that for a square matrix, M inverse is equal to the left inverse of M. There's lots of hints in the description for this, but first I want you to try question 3 because it's a very illustrative example. Suppose we have this matrix from before. If we have a left inverse for it, L, then we know L undoes M. We also know that M takes the basis vectors to these vectors, so L must take them back. First, show that these two new vectors form a basis. Then, to show that M undoes L, we need to show that for any vector V, if you apply L and then M, you get V back. Show this by writing V as a linear combination of the basis in the first part. Hopefully doing this will help you with your proof in question 2. As you will have noticed, the first question is from brilliant.org. What I like about questions from there is that they don't just give you a formula and then ask you questions where you plug numbers into that formula. That's what I found a lot of high school and early university textbooks do, and it's annoying because that doesn't teach you anything. Instead, they get you to do examples like this one and then understand the principle yourself, and then in the next few questions, lead you to finding the general solution on your own. As you can see, this is exactly how I like to learn new maths. Before reading the proof of anything, I'll do lots and lots of examples first and try and understand the underlying reasoning. So I love how Brilliant allows you to do this in a structured way. They have loads of different maths and science courses on their website, which you can access completely with a monthly or yearly membership. If you follow the link in the description or on the screen, you can get 20% off your annual subscription. Alright, so that's all for this video. I hope you enjoyed it. The next one is about changing basis, which is key to understanding loads of quantum mechanics, including the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. It should be up here in about 2 weeks, as long as I don't decide I hate it just after uploading it like I did with the original version of this one. Anyway, subscribe if you'd like to be notified when the next one is up. Thanks for watching.